Does the clicker work?
Yes, this one.
No, it does not.
Oh, yes, here.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, I advance. Yeah.
Okay, so you have a pointer?
A pointer,
yeah.
Yeah.
You have a pointer.
Thank you. Good afternoon, and thank you to the organizer for this invitation. I will speak about Helicity. Is Helicity everywhere or nowhere? And it's a preliminary study which will be continued with my colleague Fabien Godefer from my own lab in Lyon, France, and with Aziz Sali from Tunis. First, brief. My main topic is the spontaneous generation of helicities, helicities with S, because, for example, in MHD we have a three kind of helicities, and without initialization nor forcing. I will present briefly first the case of purely rotating turbulence. After, I will move to the NSF context. It's not National Science Foundation. It's N for stratification, like the Brunweisler frequency N, S for shear, and F for the Coriolis parameter. And it's an approach in which quasi-homogeneous or homogeneous turbulence is subjected to a constant uniform rate of buoyancy gradient, velocity gradient, and Coriolis force. I will move to MHD using an analogy between a cross helicity, true cross helicity in MHD, and subrogate proposed by Gibbon and Holmes and illustrated by, I will look, I will show you on the next slide. Of course, local helicity is everywhere in snapshot, but it's local. Often, it is very difficult to generate bulk helicity with statistically relevant. For example, in homogeneous turbulence, John Lomley suggested that if the symmetry in a flow with a center of symmetry, you cannot generate helicity. On the other hand, there are a lot of DNS with forcing by the group of Minini, Pouquet. There are also surgery. For example, helical modes, you can expand any velocity field in helical modes, which concentrate helicity. But often, if you add helical mode with different polarity, you cancel helicity. And only if you perform some surgery in killing some helical mode with a given polarization, you have a lot of helicity, as illustrated by a recent study by Luca Biferale and co-worker. Nevertheless, helicity spectrum, statistically relevant helicity, is very important for the alpha effect, the dynamo effect, and so on. And I will mention some work by Marino in the same team of Minini and Pouquet after. By definition, helicity is the cross kinematic helicity, because I will have other kind of helicity, is the scalar product, the correlation of a scalar product of vorticity, vorticity fluctuation, and velocity fluctuation. The first question is what kind of averaging we can use. In a statistically homogeneous turbulence, two point correlation like that correspond exactly by inverse by Fourier transform, by Friedrich Fourier transform, to an helicity spectrum. Often presence of helicity means Beltramization, so that the ratio of the Lamb vector, the modulus of the Lamb vector over this scalar product, quantifies the nonlinearity, and it is expected that when u is more aligned with omega, nonlinearity is dramatically reduced. So, is there a correlation between a kind of joint probability of alignment with the velocity spectrum? It's an open question, not completely solved. Now, looking at the symmetries, there are all helicities, I will define the other helicities after, are always product, scalar or inner product of a vector by a pseudo vector. Omega is a pseudo vector, it changes of sign by inversion, so that there is a breaking of mirror symmetry. So if you have mirror symmetry, you have no statistically relevant helicity. And I will follow my color schedule in the rest of the talk. Red will means breaking of mirror symmetry. So just a bit of statistics. I will look at two-point second-order correlation like that with R separation vector. This involves a second-order structure function, for example, but a bit more. And we have a complete equivalence, at least in homogeneous turbulence, homogeneous even strongly anisotropic, a complete equivalence between this tensor and its Fourier transform with respect to the separation vector. The wave vector corresponds to the separation vector R. And it only in Fourier space, because we can take explicitly account of incompressibility, divergence-free contribution, this guy can be represented by only four scalar or pseudo-scalar, energy E, polarization Z, and helicity. Z is complex valued so that this corresponds to four independent scalar. Calligraphic E, of course, if you spherically average, give classical energy spectrum. And we can distinguish directional and polarization anisotropy by some expansion in terms of spherical harmonics. The first harmonic gives, for example, the directional tensor for E and polarization tensor for Z. Roughly speaking, the two kinds of anisotropy are not completely formal. Directional anisotropy means the departure of the distribution of calligraphic E from a spherical spherical distribution, and it could be expanded in terms of classical spherical harmonics. And Z is a bit more complicated. It corresponds to the tensorial structure of the spectral tensor at a given wave vector, and it is also it could be generated also by spherical harmonics, but more complicated. In fact, Z represents a tensor, a deviatoric tensor. I will stop here. There are, of course, other possibility of simplified statistics by averaging, but H is lost. If you take the spherical average of H, by symmetry, it is zero. So some odd angular harmonics could survive in H, but it's another story. No time to discuss more that. I will concentrate on the first level, and I will begin first by the case of rotating turbulence, purely rotating turbulence. I will say that in homogeneous turbulence, even arbitrary anisotropic, there is no spontaneous emergence of helicity in rotating turbulence, even if the imaginary part of Z, I will comment briefly on the next slide, and H, both break the mirror symmetry, but there is no coupling. Even in turbulence from a cloud, inertial waves propagate from the cloud in a rotating frame. but by pair, so that you have always an inertial waves with positive polarization and inertial wave with negative polarization. If you add both, you have zero elasticity. It is not, this is not discussed in the paper of the Davidson team, but you can check that you have exact cancellation. It's a very nice illustration that two modes, that you have exact cancellation of elasticity when you add two helical modes, which individually concentrate elasticity. I have an example, it was not really discussed in the paper also, but with a boundary near a wall, this corresponds to an Ekman layer. In this case, if you consider up and down eddies near a wall, one eddy is moving towards the wall, one eddy is moving in the other direction, their sense of rotation are correlated with their sense of with their axial velocity, so that you add velocity. In this case, and only in this case, to my knowledge, rotating turbulence generate net elasticity. But you need a wall. It's not a homogeneous turbulence at all. Let me continue with a kind of formalism. I mentioned that the spectral tensor, which is the covariance matrix in Fourier space of velocity correlation, can be expressed in terms of Four scalar. And what is the idea? The idea is that in Fourier space, you take into account the incompressibility condition very simply, so that the velocity fluctuation has only two components, one toroidal of type toroidal, one of type poloidal, and the divergent is zero, because divergence U equal to zero means Fourier transform of U perpendicular to the wave vector. So if you correlate, if you have a cross-correlation, you have this kinematic block in which you have toroidal energy, poloidal energy, and red term break the mirror symmetry. You find, of course, elasticity, but you find also the imaginary part of the polarization term. In terms of helical mode, you recombine now with the two components in Fourier space. There are two components normal to the wave vector. You combine them with in terms of imaginary part. You have helical mode for helical mode with plus helical mode of with minus and zero. And in this case, elasticity appears on the diagonal because the helical modes diagonalize the curl. So, and Z appears naturally, the polarization term appears naturally as a cross-correlation between helical modes of opposite polarity. I am surprised that almost nobody outside our team use this polarization term. So. No problem, I continue. There are, of course, equations. They are a bit complicated. I will not discuss all these equations. Kraya introduced a very nice concept of homogeneous turbulence, homogeneity restricted to fluctuation in the presence of uniform mean velocity gradient. Mean velocity gradient can have a symmetric and anti-symmetric part, and you can write equation for all the guy which generate second order correlation, like E vector angle dependent, polarization Z, and elasticity. There is a very important term which breaks the mirror symmetry due to the rotational effect, to the rotational effect of the shear, of the, and also to to the system rotation if you are in a rotating frame. But you have no no linear coupling. These linear parts are exact, and you have no linear coupling between EZ and H. It is expected because this equation is very close to the Karman-Wharf equation you will see in over in physical space in over talk, in which you have a purely dissipative term. You have the action of the symmetric part of the gradient, the vortex, linear vortex stretching, in fact, and you have nonlinear cubic term, because the nonlinearity of Navier-Stokes is quadratic. You have a right-hand side in terms of cubic correlation. And it is possible, it could be possible to couple helicity with energy through a nonlinear term, but it's not. It's not a complete coupling if we have a theoretical study like inertial wave turbulence in which we can show that if helicity is zero, it remains zero. So it's not a definite because a wave turbulence or statistical model for this guy are not completely the truth. But we have a long experience with both nonlinear model and DNS. In DNS, it is possible to introduce through triperiodic DNS in terms of triple periodic boxes. It is possible to take into account the advection by the mean with k time dependent. I will not insist on that. It's not the important in my talk. I continue with, now I introduce the stratification. So I conserve, according to Bosonesque assumption, the velocity field remains divergence-free, so that I can keep the solenoidal or divergence-free part of the second-order correlation. And I can consider the buoyancy, because, of course, the velocity is divergence-free, but the buoyancy can fluctuate. And it's possible to add a buoyancy part in this compact decomposition. And the buoyancy is more considered as a vector, because it corresponds roughly to the gradient of a scalar. And a gradient in Fourier space is along k as the divergence in this. So instead of zero here, I have a buoyancy contribution. Very importantly, I have a given Brun-Weisler frequency. So stratification, stable stratification is answered by a constant uniform Brun-Weisler frequency. And the buoyancy fluctuation fluctuate, of course. So, so in this line, I have here a toroidal flux, buoyancy flux, a poloidal buoyancy flux, and BB scaled as an energy give a potential energy without rotation, with only stratification. The red terms are irrelevant, and gravity waves affect all these blocks. Okay. Now, if I add rotation, I have this new term, F-tor, the toroidal flux, which generates, which breaks the mirror symmetry. And as a recent result, Marino et al. Have shown that helicity following Hyde have shown that helicity is not a is no longer a conserved quantity. There is a linear coupling with the correlation of B buoyancy with a vertical vorticity component. And this correlation is completely linked to what I call the toroidal energy flux. So the helicity equation in one point physical space is like that, and its spectral counterpart include a new linear term involving the toroidal energy flux. And of course, there is a non-linear term, but with zero integral, which means that when you integrate over k this equation, you recover that, of course. I will not comment this technical point. Just one of the main results of Marino et al. Is this interesting relationship, which involves not only the full helicity, but only the helicity linked to the horizontal component of the velocity. But it is only to simplify the equation, and I think they could find a similar result with the complete helicity, because helicity is really a scalar. It's not linked to particular component, of course. Now, let me continue and finish with MIHD. We have, if we, now we consider a combination of N and F. We have vertical stabilizing stratification characterized by N. You have Coriolis force characterized by F. And we have a coupling of H with the toroidal flux of energy. And following Hyde, Marino et al. Found a nice equivalence of helicity in terms of the ratio N over F. Okay. But I think the result depends on a bit of non-zero initial either F-tor or either H. If there are strictly zero initially, the linear solution gives no generation. So the generation is probably due to weak initial noise or some weak non-linearity. If you cancel completely non-linearity or have a strictly zero helicity and zero toroidal flux, you have nothing. So it was also found by Pieri et al., with my colleague, find you control perhaps a bit better the initial data, and they have no kinematic helicity. But in counterpart, they find, they illustrate a nice proposal by Gibbon and Holmes to define a strange correlation like that, a new B vector, which is completely equivalent, we have the same equation, as cross helicity in MIHD. This will be my transition to MIHD. I have no time to discuss that. You will have to look at the original reference, because it's complicated. It's the gradient of the potential vorticity cross the gradient of buoyancy. Okay. And this is the only PRL of my long career in which you have some discussion of that. I move to MIHD, and I will finish soon, I think. When you have true MHD, you have a free kind of helicity, of course, kinematic helicity, the same for the magnetic helicity, with a caveat is that it's not B cross omega, B cross G. J in English is the current field. People use more the vector, the magnetic vector A. So they construct more A cross B, A scalar product B than G cross B. But there is only a K2 factor between them. And the helicity B rotation, curl of B, can be called super magnetic helicity. Often people called super when the spectrum is multiplied by K2. And of course, cross-helicity is only the scalar product of U with B. And we can define the spectra and co-spectra for all these quantities. Now, I continue my little game to identify the most important correlator with a minimum number of components, taking into account incompressibility, divergence-free for both U and B. You have two components of U in Fourier space, two components of B in Fourier space, using, for example, the helical modes. So you recover exactly the kinematic block here, as before. You have exactly the similar magnetic block here, in which all these quantities are affected by M as magnetic. And you have a more complicated cross block, cross velocity magnetic field block, which contain cross helicity and also the spectrum of the electromotive force. Other Z terms are not completely identified, interpreted just now. But we have an interesting thing to look at. Calculation DNS with my colleague also Favier et al. MHD, but with additional additional rotation and additional mean magnetic field. Give a very important new result in terms of the Elsasser number, which is close to a Rossby number with omega in the denominator, so that small Elsasser number means strong rotation. And I will finish with a few results, not new, unfortunately. Here we can see that the equipartition between magnetic and kinetic energy is broken by rotation, so that at strong rotation, the magnetic energy is much smaller than the kinetic energy. About alignment, alignment has something to do with cross helicity, I remember. You can find with PDF that without rotation, U and B are almost aligned. And with increasing rotation, U and B becomes more and more perpendicular. And unfortunately, my own new result with respect to the, to Favier et al, I will give give more. You can read if you have not a good eyes. You can read this. It's an angular spectrum of cross-helicity, purely linear. Now we will have a very rapidly, completely non-linear result from DNS. And this scale, this is modulated by, in terms of VEA is the Alphen velocity, so the mean magnetic field scaled as a velocity, over F, the Coriolis parameter. And it's possible to show that, of course, if you average on the angle between the wave vector and the direction of the mean magnetic field, you have zero, but you have non-zero angle-dependent spectra. I move to my perspective. Sorry for giving you so few new results. It's a study in progress. But very formally, we will derive all the Lean equation in spectral space for the angle-dependent spectra for all the stuff I have shown. We have done that for magnetic and kinetic energy. We will do for the free energy to look at all the coupling and a possible scenario in the presence of B and twice omega, so in line with the previous DNS, I have not cited Lennert. I didn't who introduce also rotating domains, and Keith Moffat also look at rotating MHD. And a scenario which, with emergence, a successive emergence of a full helicity from the one of cross helicity, in addition to previous suggestion, because they are not complete calculation by Hyde and by Keith Moffat. Application, it's a toy model, because if we are in homogeneous turbulence without boundary, it's a toy model, but we hope to have possible application to geodynamo with additional stratification, taking into account all ingredients, B, omega, B, F, and also N, and perhaps an approximation like quasi-static MHD could be useful for liquid metal in the core of the Earth. Thank you for your attention.